We're going to get rolling into our next panel. Can we get the dust in the panel up here? That'd be great. Please welcome Barb Monroe and her amazing panel, Today's Talent in Today's World.
All right, I am working, good. All right, hello again, everyone. My name is Barb Monroe, and in addition to my role and responsibilities with Sim San Diego, I'm also the co-founder and partner at the Carrera Agency, which is a talent management firm specializing in IT and digital design consulting. I will be moderating today's session on talent in today's world. We have an esteemed panel here, and I'm going to let them, I'll do this a little differently, I'm going to let them introduce themselves, starting with Erica.
Thanks, Barb. So Erica Hausheer, I'm the CIO at Teradata. I've been there for about a year. Prior to that, CIO at 3D Systems, a 3D printing company, and before that, 20 years at HP.
Thanks, Erica. John.
John Zavada. I'm the Chief Administrative Officer at Petco. I have been there at Petco for about 5 years. Prior to that, with many other retailers in a CIO capacity at Restoration Hardware, Victoria's Secret Stores, Big Lots, Guitar Center. My area is a little bit different from the perspective of oversee the world of IT, also advanced analytics and data science, plus a series of other administrative areas like call center, procurement, internal audit, and a few other areas. So, a lot of diverse talent.
I'll say.
My name is Aviva McPherron. I lead up the IT team at NuVasive. I've been in that role for about 3 years and been at NuVasive for about 10 years. Prior to that, I've been in technology for most of my career, 20, 25 years, started out as a developer, and that was at Boeing prior to joining NuVasive.
Thanks, Aviva.
Thanks. That's Carrie. She and I used to work together at NuVasive.
Carrie is everyone's fan today.
Yes.
And good afternoon, Jeff Lindeman. I'm the Chief HR Officer for WD-40 Company, and I've been with the company for about 5 years, the first four of which was spent in our EMEA business unit. And then prior to that, I've got a background in both the airport and retail industries.
All right, thank you, everyone. All right, my job here is to set the stage for, I think, what it'll be a very interesting discussion, top of mind for most people in this room, talent. So I think it is fair to say that due to the pandemic, everybody is reevaluating their lives and what's important to them. And for those of us still working, many of us are looking at more work-life balance. Employers are concerned about talent retention and attraction, and rightly so. Recently in the San Diego Business Journal, they cited that for the month of August here in San Diego County, there were more than 118,000 unique job openings. And no surprise, the two top industries where those jobs were posted were tech and life sciences. And not coincidentally, the Harvard Review stated that it was tech and healthcare that had the highest number of resignations nationally. So that is also something for us to be cognizant about here. I will say that most of the things I've read talk about the resignation being with mid-career employees, so something to be cognizant about. And one more stat for you, not to be doom and gloom, but Robert Half, like citing these surveys, Robert Half recently did a survey interviewing IT professionals, and over one-third of them said that in the next couple of months, they will be looking for another job, giving credence to what the tech industry is calling the Great Resignation. So burnout, I think a growing number of competing opportunities, an influx of VC capital for startups are all contributing to this talent migration. Most people aren't going to want to hear this, but what experts are saying that you need as an employer to be flexible and give your talent remote work, or you are going to have a major turnover problem. So some suggestions to retain talent include giving employees autonomy to do their jobs, giving them the tools to do their jobs effectively. And this was touched on earlier today in one of our sessions, giving people a sense of purpose. You know, what is their role in the organization and what is their overall purpose so that they feel committed to the organization. And also, some experts are advising companies to become more active than usual in things like your local universities, tech organizations, professional organizations, symposiums, local chambers, written publications. I think you get the picture. To actually have a positive presence, be well known. It's all about branding. So be visible and become the employer of choice. So companies, as you know today, are not just competing against other local companies here in San Diego for talent. You are now competing with companies both nationally and globally. It is a real challenge. So personally, I've had my talent management firm for over 20 years, and I have never seen the talent market this hot or this volatile. So with these challenges in mind, we're going to jump into our interesting discussion here with our panelists, and they're going to give you their insights and perspectives on what you need to know in this challenging hiring arena and what you should do to stay on top. So with that, I'm going to start with you, John.
Okay.
What challenges are companies facing in today's hiring landscape, and what new opportunities exist?
Great. Thanks. So for Petco in particular, I mean, everyone is dealing with this situation on the talent side, so I don't think there's going to be any mystery to kind of some of the things that we're dealing with in the hiring, retention, and development of talent. So we're in the same boat with this as we're kind of all working through this together. We're dealing with all the same types of challenges where we're dealing with individuals that are leaving for, I was talking about this a little bit before during the break around what I describe as being stupid offers, things that are just absurdly high with very, very rich compensation packages that don't make sense to even match. So people are leaving for opportunities that are extraordinarily aggressive. So you've got that. You've got a talent kind of hiring situation where you're dealing with competitive offers that are dealing with the same types of things. And then you've also just got general development that you're focused on, too, on trying to help people develop in a remote environment and having to be able to do that in a way that they feel like they're continuing to grow within an organization and have the same opportunities they have with you as they would with some other companies. So from my perspective, these are all the challenges. And I think one of the things I would say is that we're a little bit in uncharted waters here because it's kind of funny. Barb mentions kind of the comment that she hasn't seen it in 20 years. I've been a hiring manager now for 30 years. I'm a lot older.
Okay.
And as a result of that, the last time I've seen anything like this, even resembling this even remotely, would have been probably the dot-com boom, and that was a very narrow set of technologists that were part of that. So benchmarks don't matter. You can't have a compensation leader look at something and go, oh, looking at the historical trend and looking at positions and saying, hey, you know what, this position should be at this market and this compensation model. So we're actually having to break the playbook, frankly, with my HR partner on some select areas where it's critical for our company to have certain talent. And we're going off of kind of normal ways that we would navigate this because there's really nothing to benchmark against. And it's a bit of uncharted waters on kind of working through this as we're kind of evaluating our market and where to go with that. So it's definitely a challenging market, and it's something that we're going to continue to have to learn as we go, frankly, because it is something that is, I think, new from the standpoint of things that we're dealing with right now and kind of take what we've learned from the past, but also try and figure out where we're going and figure out how to anticipate where the talent market's going to be and how we retain and how we hire talent is a bit of the learning curve here. So lots to learn.
And you need a crystal ball. So, Erica, how about you with your organization?
So, at Teradata, a couple of things. One, we're really trying to turn all the threats of what's going on with hiring, turn them into positives. So, if the threat is employees can easily jump from one company to another without thinking about, do I move my family across state lines or across the city, right? They don't have to think about that anymore. They'll take a new job and they'll just walk to their living room and do the same thing that they did in their old job. How do we make that an opportunity? Mm-hmm. We made a decision probably about 2 quarters ago that we would support flexible work. We would support hiring in any location. So you need to know, is it a US location, it is a Europe location. Obviously, some jobs need to be location specific, but for tech talent, we've said you can hire anywhere. And so having worked at HP for years, I have a lot of networks that I haven't hired in the past because for some odd reason, they did not want to move to San Diego. I don't understand that. But now I'm hiring people from anywhere as long as they're in the right time zone or within one or two time zones. So the threat was people can jump easily. Turn that into an offensive. Yes, people can jump easily. Attract your top talent that you know from the past to come and work for you. So I think that's just a mindset shift. Look at the threats, turn them into opportunities. Then the next thing is, okay, so if everybody does that, what's unique about what your company, what's your unique value prop? So our CEO is very committed, not only in how he shows up in social media, but also personally to DEI. So we always are publicizing diversity, equity, inclusion, not only in what we talk about, but how we behave. We're one of the most ethical companies. And so taking advantage of those things and saying what makes Teradata different than maybe some of the other companies out there. We happen to be in the data industry, as we've talked all day. You guys, data's not going away. It's perhaps exploding, not shrinking. And so for us, it was really about turn threats into opportunities and then differentiate. What is different about you than perhaps some of the other companies that are looking for that same talent?
Right, branding is important. And also, on the positive side, from an employer perspective, if you're open to hiring people anywhere, then that's going to open up your talent pool to get you the seasoned, specialized talent that you might not otherwise get here locally. So I think that's a really smart way of approaching it. So Jeff, our Chief Human Resource Officer from WD-40.
As each of the answers were coming previously, I felt the pressure mounting.
So we talked about talent attraction. Let's talk retention. So what is your organization, and you've got quite a great reputation here, honestly, in San Diego, WD-40. What are you doing to understand and improve employee engagement, and how is that impacting retention in your firm?
Thank you. So thank you for the setup and the kind words. And just to sort of frame the context of my answer, globally, we do business in about 175 countries around the world, but we only employ people in 16 countries. And the way I make sense of it in my head is our business model is similar to Coca-Cola's, where we make the IP, the secret sauce that goes in to the can, but we contract out with partners around the world in order to fill the cans, aerosolize them, distribute them, et cetera. So we're a market cap company of $3.5 billion, but we only have about 550 employees globally. So that just puts some context. But we're purpose-driven and values-guided. And that allows us to tap into people's intrinsic motivators. And our employee engagement globally is about 93%, and that's held firm for the last 6 years. We're about to go through another cycle to assess that. But in the midst of the pandemic in January of last year, we did a pulse survey to just ask some key questions, and our scores remained the same or went up. Because I think what we learned was that we were doing a better job in communicating with people, a better job in informing people about the different parts of the business, what our decision-making process was, how the pandemic was impacting our decision-making, and I think we took our competence and made it even stronger over the course of the pandemic. We have a business driver, one of five that we're refreshing now that'll go out to six, but it's a business driver that was called attract, retain, and attract, develop, and retain high-performing tribe members, and we've refreshed that, and we took retention out. So we did attract, develop, and engage, because we think that if we do those things right, the retention number will follow. So rather than chasing the retention number, we wanted to actually focus on what we can do. The most important relationship in the workplace is between an individual and their boss. So that relationship is critical. And just a byproduct of this, I was sharing with Doug that I did my homework before coming here today, and our fiscal year is September through August. And last fiscal year through August, which was the great resignation in the US, the difference in voluntary separations was less than a handful globally. So if we do the attract, if you hire the right people, if you develop them, even though there's a risk that they'll leave, and you engage them, we found that we've not had the trendy influence that you would see in the media today.
I remember in our earlier discussion, you were talking about taking that positive approach. Don't look about, you know, I was reading articles about, you know, companies should be using artificial intelligence and other data means to be tracking, predicting actually, why people are leaving the organizations and track that data so that you can then take that information and try and institute some preventative measures for that. But you took just the opposite approach. You're talking to people saying, why are you staying?
Why do you stay? Yeah.
Which is so smart, right? Which is so smart. And they keep repeating that model and that way. So I think that's brilliant. Aviva, how about you?
Yeah, no, great story over here. I'd have to say for us, it's been a little bit more challenging. We are seeing we're seeing turnover go up and we're starting to see engagement go down. So we're kind of, just within my department, kind of taking a bottoms up, top down, and kind of middle out approach. And by bottoms up, I mean just having those conversations with the people who are here and the people who've been here for a long time. Like, what is it about the place that makes you stay, that makes you plugged in, that makes you engaged? What are things that we can do more of? And that's an incredible data set. You know, like one of the little things that we found was that people had development plans. They were encouraged to do development, but they felt like if they took time to do personal development, they were letting their team down. Mm-hmm. Like, well, okay, that's something that we can all collectively put our arms around and do something about. The other one is from the top-down perspective, I think, you know, that mission-driven organization is incredibly important, refining your purpose, refining your mission, but then really connecting your goals to kind of the enterprise goals. And that might sound simple and obvious, but when we're all apart right now and you don't have that opportunity for that hallway conversation to really clarify something and ask that question and check in, I found that getting a lot crisper in how that work that you do connects becomes really, really important. And then the final point, and I think you also talked about it, your frontline managers. We recently got our engagement survey back, and there was a fascinating correlation. You probably have all seen this as well. There's a direct correlation between how often you're meeting with your frontline manager and your engagement score. If you're meeting less frequently, people are less engaged, full stop. Now, we don't want that to just be a check-the-box exercise. So the other area that we're really starting to dig into is how do we develop our frontline managers? How do we give them the tools in this environment to really connect with their employees and to keep that conversation going? So those are kind of three of the areas that we're really digging into now.
Well, that's just a perfect segue into another question that we had talked about is, you know, how do you set up your managers? I'm skipping around a little bit here, but they don't know, managers and leaders to be successful in that hybrid remote work environment. Because as we know, I think it goes for any of us. I don't care if you're a CIO, a CAO, you know, what your stature in the organization is. If you don't work for a leader that you like and you respect and they respect you in return, then it's not going to be a mutually beneficial relationship, right? So that is key. So let me ask you, Erica, you know, what do you do to set up your managers and leaders for success? They are so critical to keeping your employees at your company.
Yeah, it's an interesting notion. And for us, it started with your job as a manager, as a leader, your purpose, your intention, your core reason for being hasn't changed. You need to engage with your employees. You need to help them understand what's expected of them. You need to praise them when they do a good job. You need to challenge them. You need to help them to grow. None of that changed when the pandemic hit. Now, what they were doing might have changed, especially if you were in IT operations, but the purpose of a manager didn't change. So then you shifted to, okay, now let's talk about different ways you're going to work. You can't walk past their desk or catch them in the hallway anymore. So how do you create those hallway conversations over IM? How do you ensure that you have more frequent, perhaps shorter one-on-ones? How do you think about preparing for your staff differently? How do you make sure it's not just you talking at your staff, but it's them talking with you, right? How do you, I've done a couple virtual workshops. I was one of the crazy people that changed companies in the middle of the pandemic. So I had to do workshops with my team. How do you design and facilitate that? Mm. Which is very different from put stickies on a whiteboard. Now all of a sudden you have to think about that differently. But it came back to my job as a leader is the same as it was pre-pandemic, my core purpose. So what new skills, tools do I need? And some people needed a lot of new tools because they've always worked in a physically face-to-face, this is how I work. Other people you'll find have worked in global companies in the past and they're like, oh yeah, this is what I do, this is how I do this. And so identifying those people who found it very natural to make the shift to virtual and having them share their best practices with their colleagues so that everybody could build those skills.
Yeah, that knowledge sharing and that mentoring would be key, especially in this virtual time. Jeff, how about your perspective from an HR perspective?
I would underscore the same things that Erica had just shared and probably invite people to think about it from the standpoint of who do you want to be, right? What do you want people to experience from you? Not necessarily the activities that I have to complete. Example, last Sunday was my 5-year anniversary with the company, and I happened to have been out of town on business trip, and the CEO had messaged me to say, are you in town or are you out of town? No, I'm out of town. Okay, so he calls, and I'm thinking, what did I screw up? But it was my 5-year anniversary, and I had forgotten about it, and he had a bottle of champagne that he wanted to drop off at home, right? So who wouldn't want that from the CEO of their company or your boss, really, to acknowledge something as simple as a 5-year milestone? But the bottle of champagne, which I eventually got, has a thank you note, a handwritten thank you note of specific things that he's grateful for the contributions that I've made in just a 5-year tenure. And keep in mind, he's been in role for 25 years, so it's my one time to be a baby, right? It's my one time to be the young person in the organization. So leaders have that opportunity, that relationship between the leader and the individual that they lead. That relationship is so important, and who do you want to be in that moment? There are times where the soundtrack in my head is, what the hell were you thinking? But the words that come out of my mouth are, help me understand what you were thinking, right? Yeah. It's that moment. Yeah. So do I want to be that person who's, you know, just venting to people, or do I want to be the person who genuinely wants to understand? I have people that are all over the world that I now have the opportunity to support. The screen time, whereas previously it would have been a conference call, that screen time gives me the opportunity to get to know them and over the pandemic, get to know them in their homes, get to know their kids, which I wouldn't have had. Mm-hmm. Being able to send handwritten thank you notes to people or to their kids through the post. One woman that worked for me had been seriously ill, and she's rarely misses work, but at the end she said, you're going to be really proud. My 11-year-old son did his best to take good care of me. So I sent him a thank you note in the mail. You know, we work really hard to take care of your mom while she's in the office, and I'm so glad to know that she had you to take care of her at home.
Excellent. I mean, it really is that human element. We're all people, and we should be thoughtful, and we should be kind, and we should have that filter, even though sometimes it's really hard for me to filter with my kids. But you should have that filter, and because people appreciate it, like you. I mean, that was just such an easy gesture, how thoughtful, and again, that will further build that allegiance and loyalty.
I have crap handwriting. But I wasn't judged on that, right? I was judged by the fact that I took the time to, in block letters, write it out, put the stamp on it, and send it in the post.
Right. Thank you. So, John, I know we had talked about work culture being so important. I know some of our other panels talked about leadership, culture, how you attract the talent and retain it. But, what are your thoughts on building a healthy work culture in a remote work environment? That's not easy.
It's not easy at all. And it's been interesting. One of the things that we've done as we've looked at the remote environment is we've looked at it from the perspective kind of bifurcating it into kind of different situations. You've got your existing kind of tenured individuals that have been with the company, and it's similar to WD-40, kind of purpose-driven company. People that resonate and have been with the brand all along the way. So you have a population of individuals who know the brand, knew things prior to COVID-19, and weren't working in a remote environment. So they understood the culture of the company, and they could translate that to some respect into a remote world and didn't lose that along the way. So it's that population. I have the experience of I actually built an entire team during this period of time of COVID from the ground up. We have an enterprise analytics and data science organization that did not exist. So this is a team of approximately 25 individuals who the entire team was hired during this period of time and hired from a remote situation and going to be remote. That population is a big challenge for you to get them to understand the purpose-driven culture and connect up to that. So the engagement word has been used a lot in this entire day, and that's one of the key things, is ensuring that the leaders and the levels of leadership in there are engaging with their team on an ongoing basis, and also ensuring that you're driving what the purpose is and what the company is all about. Some of the things that we've done with that to try and help with that other population of individuals who are new to the company is ensuring that there's strong engagement by the leader, as talked about already, but also aspects of involving them in a broader set of meeting settings and broader population of the company. And actually giving them exposure to individuals, even if they were within the company in an in-person type situation, to ensure that they have exposure to lots of different levels in the organization and a lot of different leaders in the organization, so they can understand why the company is here, what the purpose is in establishing that culture. We increased the number of town hall meetings we had on a virtual basis to, again, create that engagement, create that connection point. The other one that has been really good for us has been our internal social platform. So we're a big workplace shop where we basically have rolled workplace out enterprise-wide. And that has also created a phenomenon for people to engage and understand what's going on through the different channels about what the company's about, so they can get connected to the brand and what we're all about. Activity during this period of time has more than doubled with the leverage of workplace in our environment on the social platforms. And then there's also other platforms such as Slack and Teams and other things that really allow people to feel that there's a more seamless connection to a working environment, so they can feel part of a community. Because if there isn't that community feel, one of the things we've started to notice is a lot of the individuals, we've seen more turnover actually lately within people that have been with the company less than a year than people that were more than a year. Because as easy as it was for them to join you, it's just as easy for them to leave now. And there's a risk of less stickiness associated with that situation if you can't create that kind of brand purpose-driven areas. And certain team members and certain leaders have done a better job of that in an organization, and others have kind of missed the boat and has created a situation where people are exiting as fast as they're coming in. So it's been a challenge, learning as we go, but creating that connection to the purpose and creating those connection points in a sense of community is really, really pivotal.
Well, and connectedness is so important, which is why we decided to have this event in person today, right? And so it sounds like you guys are doing all the right things. And brand, I hear brand consistently. The brand of your organization, the brand is you as a leader, and the brand of your ever so important other leaders within your organization to keep the employees happy and wanting to stay. So Aviva, how about NuVasive? What's NuVasive doing as far as the healthy work culture?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. We found some of the same things. Again, looking at our survey data, the folks who joined in the last 1 to 3 years, there's just this dip in engagement. And you're like, what else was going on? And really, what have we done to plug them into the organization? And so some of it comes back to, you know, enabling the frontline leaders, the managers, you know, helping them understand, like, their role is to enable the success of their team. I do think there's probably a desire, especially in newer managers, to go in and, like, you're checking in and how are things going, you know, especially in the remote environment. And so, like, kind of helping people understand that people feel more engaged when they have, I think Barbie mentioned it, autonomy, mastery, purpose, and helping frontline managers kind of really understand that. The other thing that is kind of paradoxical, I think, and you said it, we're in uncharted waters. We're all gonna have to be flexible and kind of learn as we go. But I think people enjoy being remote. They enjoy not having the interruptions and the drive-bys and not having the commute. I do think there's a corollary to not feeling as connected and as plugged in, and I still think we're figuring that out. One of the opportunities we have being more hybrid that we're exploring is maybe once a quarter we come together and we look at, okay, how does the work we're doing connect to our higher level goals. You know, engage with each other on the personal level, have those hallway conversations and things like that. And then the final thing, and this might seem super, super tactical, but Zoom fatigue is real. It's real. and so we're trying to, you know, really, people know when you need a meeting and when you don't, and no one needs you to read slides to you. You can read them faster than I can speak to them.
This is why we're in person here, Aviva.
Yes. And you know, everything's like proliferated and expanded and filled up all the space, and so we're just trying to reset that culture a little bit and be like, can this be asynchronous? Can we send you the slides and come together
right.
for the decision?
Right.
Or for the connection, the personal connection. You said it. We're inviting each other into each other's homes. That's the connection. That's the meaningful time to get on camera. Otherwise, we can be old-fashioned and pick up the phone sometimes.
It's funny. When I'm talking to somebody for the first time or somebody has introduced me, they want to go right to a Zoom call. And I'm like, no, I'm doing it the old-fashioned. I'll call you. What's your work number?
Exactly.
Or cell number? Because I'm just not, everyone's so programmed to do those visuals. It's like, you know, I'm in my sweats and I didn't do my hair or makeup today, so I'm not going to do it. I'm going to do it the old-fashioned way. So there's a time and a place to have all the visual, all the Zoom, because it just gets
totally.
To be too much. We need to get beyond it.
It's so, been interesting. There's been studies about that, specifically around what your mind has to do with a visual cue versus a non-visual cue. And it's back, the science says it's exhausting.
Yeah.
If your every meeting is a Zoom kind of video type thing versus being broken up, you will be unbelievably exhausted by the end of the day.
Yeah, I think Steve Philpott talked about it earlier, that he gives people the options, like, okay, we're going to have this Zoom call, but you don't have to be on a visual if you don't want. If it's not relevant, you know, if you're not speaking, you're just listening, why do you have to have the visual?
Yep.
So this is actually a good segue into mental health and wellness, which I think is a super important topic. So many individuals are struggling. I've talked to a few people here today that talk about their own personal mental health struggles or their employees. And what can we do to help these people? We all have our bad days. We all have the stuff that we've got to deal with. But it's compounded now by the world in which we live with all the virtual stuff going on. So, Jeff, what is WD-40 doing in regard to, you know, are you in tune with the mental health and wellness of your own employees? And what are you as a company doing to support mental health and wellness?
Thank you. Probably basic things that most companies are. We discovered during the pandemic that we didn't have an employee assistance program around the world. So we rolled that out. So that was a surprise to me. The Calm app and things of that nature. But probably, again, I think it goes back to this, the relationship between the individual and their boss is the most important relationship. Boss knows more than I ever would sitting in an office about the stress and the challenges that people's lives are presenting to them. So we just did a workshop 2 weeks ago. We did it with our board, senior management, with authors of a book called Anxiety at Work. What's beautiful about it is not only does it describe all the factors that cause anxiety at work, but it also gives you tips and strategies for how to navigate each one of them in every chapter. So we're trying to provide some learning experiences for our senior leaders to then cascade down. So some people are doing book club within their teams. They're reading a chapter, talking about it. So we're trying to help people organically where they're at and help them navigate the complexities of their lives. We've done things like, if people were challenged, we've met them for walks, we've done walking meetings with them, we've done walking just to listen to the challenges of homeschooling and all of the stresses that had almost nothing to do with work, but it was in the context of it's getting in the way of my work, and therefore I need to talk about this.
Yeah, it's so important. I think I mentioned it when I was doing the SIM presentation, that we had somebody come in and talk about mental health, wellness, mindfulness for our Women in Technology group, and it was so well received, and it was so, you know, right point in time for people to have somebody talk about that and have an actual workshop on that and what they can do for themselves mentally to stay balanced, quite frankly. So we have time for one more question. So here we are still in COVID, unfortunately. And anything positive? Eric, I'm looking at you. Anything, give me something positive that has come out of this. I will kick it off by saying the one thing, I'm an in-person people kind of person, if in case you didn't know. I like seeing people in person. But the one thing I will say about the Zoom calls is it gave me some insights into people's personal lives. You got the dog, you know, on the screen, or the cat walking across the, you know, the keyboard, or the kids are, Mom, I'm on a call, thank you. Or just even seeing their home environment, their personal space. I found that very insightful as to, gosh, this is a more of a human element I'm seeing with people that I would not have otherwise seen in the work environment. So Erica, what are your thoughts?
So I think there are a couple of, from a horrible situation, a couple positives that have come out. First of all, for all of you that are in infrastructure and operations, the part of IT that's behind the scenes, treated like a utility company, you got to shine. So that's a positive.
There you go.
We finally got infrastructure and ops people. We're at the forefront doing amazing things, keeping the company running. So I did not come through that chain, but I thought that was great. On a more serious note, for me, we're all virtual. So I've worked at global companies my whole career, tech companies my whole career, and you always had those couple of people who were in the wrong time zone, couldn't be in the conference room, never felt as connected as the people who were there locally. Well, now all of a sudden, we're all calling in from our living room, our spare bedroom, our closet, wherever it happens to be.
Our closet?
And it felt...
I won't ask anymore.
It really created a level playing field. Everybody's dialing in from wherever they are. So there was no more in-the-meetings that some of the people couldn't mm-hmm. hear. There was no more, oh, I didn't get to see the whiteboard. Everybody was the same. Yeah. And I thought that was a huge positive. And in my team, you know, there are some folks who are like, yeah, but when we go back to normal. And I said, no, you have a global team. Mm-hmm. Let's not go back to normal where you ignored the people in other countries. How about we maintain this even playing field so everybody in your team, everybody in the company has the same opportunity to contribute? So to me, that was a big positive.
Right. It's a new mindset now. It's like, okay, we were forced to do this, and now you see the benefit of doing that, right? And so, John, you're gonna close it out for us. What are your thoughts?
So I have a couple more, but I will, to Erica's point, we had a similar situation. We had a satellite office in San Antonio where that particular team was always in a situation where our primary office was in the office, and they always felt like they were the stepchild of the organization.
The redheaded stepchild. I know you want to say
that. I do want to say that.
So this did level the playing field, and actually the engagement scores in that particular organization actually went up, mm-hmm. interestingly, as part of that process. They actually felt more engaged with the company and was one of the few areas that actually, through this process, actually were more engaged because of that. So that is something, one of the things we're watching as we get into this hybrid environment, how do we make sure we don't, as you say, go right back to that and create that phenomenon where it's like, hey, I can't hear the side conversation that's going on around the boardroom table, et cetera. So that is something we're watching for. I think the other area, and it was really hit well in today's session, is one of the things it's kind of a residual benefit is, frankly, I think security and the investment in security because of the world of COVID has dramatically taken a front and center investment area. So I think from an industry perspective and for what our world is, I think because of all the risk and exposure associated with this remote world and the fact that the bad guys are remote also, it has created a better IT infrastructure investment pool as it relates to security. So I think we will, longer term, benefit in that investment level based on the fact that we're more remote. Lastly, the area that I would say is kind of a soft one is, I happen to be an individual who, as part of my career development, I moved all over the country in order to advance in my career, in order to get, so I had six moves as an executive level to different parts of either the state or the country. I think this provides an opportunity, frankly, when you think about the benefit to an individual who has to take kids out of high school and move into another, the quality of life aspects of what this might mean, frankly, from the perspective of a different work dynamic and people to be able to not have to have that as be a fundamental choice of being having to relocate, I think is going to change things from the perspective of people feeling as though I have a better connection to a community that I'm in, I'm not doing things to disrupt my kids' life in order to make a career advancement. I think that is a big benefit, and from a societal perspective, that we could get that is basically the half glass full side of the remote world that we should really be thinking about, because that actually is very, very important that people feel connected to their community and to their family. So
that's a great perspective, John. It really is. And I, you know, we could talk about this for a long time, talent, but alas, we're done. Unless they gave me 3 minutes left, do we have any questions? We actually have a couple minutes left. So who cares? Oh, it
That's
is going the opposite direction. Well, okay, yeah, you're right. All right, but do we have any questions? Anybody?
Yes, I have a question. John, you had talked about the newest employees had a tendency to be leaving more so than the current employees that you had. Just wondering, with some of the survey work that you've done, is there any correlation to the quality of the onboarding that was done for the new hires that may have contributed to them not feeling as connected and ready to do their job, and therefore it was easy for them to unplug and say sayonara?
It's a good question and a good challenge. And we have not really adjusted our onboarding process to compensate for that. That's been some things that we've been learning through. I think it's a great idea, is just to figure out, you know what, do you engage to a different level than you would have in the past as far as the onboarding process to get them more connected with the experience. So I think that's a great call out.
Naresh.
Hi, everybody. Great insights today. So something I'm thinking about, how some of the local companies here can take this forward. We talk about retention, we're talking about all of that. We're getting to that end of the fiscal year thing, the annual budgets, the salary increases, the bonuses. And how are you guys all managing the annual and quarterly reviews of these employees remotely and dealing with the, you know, this person really needs to change and the whole dynamics, because I'm anticipating another surge of people saying, oh, I didn't get a good review, I'm out of here. So what are your thoughts?
Erica,
yeah.
Go ahead.
So I think for me, you know, as we all know it, it happens, but turn every negative into a positive. So for your top performers who you suspect might be interested, do all the great manager behaviors to show them some love. Are you investing? Have you asked them about their development plan? How are they doing? How do you create snickiness from them? Give them the great project that they want to be on as we transition through the money timing in March when everybody decides to jump. So if you really, you know, look at your team and say, these people I have to keep, what are you doing to create stickiness? Not with money, but with exciting assignments and showing them appreciation and giving them opportunity to shine in front of the broader group, so that they feel sticky and they feel committed. That probably means you have less energy and time to put into some of the other folks who maybe you want to leave. Okay, that's okay.
Or take away their stock option. Say, sorry, I was only kidding. We're gonna defer that for another year or two. So you're gonna have to stay. So that's a good way to build a relationship. Anybody else?
That was not my answer.
I know, right.
There's a bunch of great tools out there. I don't know if you guys have heard of Mural or Miro, like concurrent whiteboarding tools. I actually almost like them better than regular whiteboards because everybody can input information at the same time. So you can collect a ton of information concurrently, and then you can kind of like vote or consensus to narrow down. So I actually find it faster and more collaborative, and also you get more participation instead of like, you know, we're introverts. I'm an introvert, at least. I'll speak for myself. So instead of asking that question, like, hey, who has an idea? And like, you know, one person can dominate the room. Everybody can quietly go in, put all the virtual stickies on the board. And we found it in the right way, used in the right way, to be just an awesome collaboration tool that we want to carry forward.
And Aviva, not that I'm advertising for Miro, but we just did a selection, and that was our preferred tool as well. And we did a pilot with marketing people and engineers, and they both love that.
It's a bunch of, I have no stock in them, but there's a bunch of, you can get free licenses and just try it out. There's a bunch of them, but I agree.
Yeah.
All right, before Hunter kicks us off the stage, I guess that we will call it a wrap. Thank you, everyone, for your insightful wisdom here.
Pretty good.